الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. There are many verses in the Quran that starts with يا أيها الذين آمنوا, or you who believe. And it's an act of worship, one of the forms of worship, عبودية, is that a Muslim would seek what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him or from her. Not just to live one's life according to how people are acting and behaving, and then once in a while a person would check and ask what is the ruling here or there. No. The Muslim, the believers, they are seeking constantly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them first, and then they would act in this life accordingly. So that's why the knowledge comes before action. And one of which is that we go by each verse in the Quran and the authentic sunnah of the Prophet والسلام, to get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in all of our affairs, in matters of belief, in matters of worship, in eating and drinking, in relationships, in anything in our life, we have to go through according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do. One of these calls in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 172. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كلوا من طيبات ما رزقناكم واشكروا لله إن كنتم إياه تعبدون. Order. يا أيها الذين آمنوا, this is the call. This is the call that comes before the order. And as we heard before, this beautiful call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has its meanings of mercy and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, if He orders, there's no need for any form of call. Kulu, eat from the tayyibat. This is enough for the believers. But when the believers, they hear, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, then they would feel this honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, is calling them. They would have the perfect shyness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that how come first they're not seeking to learn these verses? They're away from getting to know these calls from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers. If they are believers, that means they are looking for these verses in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, He would say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe. So the person would subject himself to such a great group, the best of all mankind, those who are believers. And the shyness that a person would hear, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, and won't submit fully to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without no hesitation whatsoever. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. بمقتضى الإيمان. If you are believers, then do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered in these verses. This is what the verses means. If you are believers, then we submit to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses. And the believers, they have good expectations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they would never be ruined if they would submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders only to what is good, and He forbid all that is evil. Even if people say otherwise, who is to say when the Most High, the Almighty, the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, would say that to do this and not to do that. Human beings tend to be arrogant when they are so deficient and so weak, and they cannot help themselves to push away any small harm that they don't see with their own eyes, like a virus or a bacteria. They cannot fight and push away sleep when it overpowers them. And then when they are awake, when they have the means of tongue to say things, they act arrogantly. They think that they do not need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They can figure it out their own way. They have minds to think. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, in the very first verses that was revealed. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم كلا إن الإنسان لا يطغى أرآه استغنى. Very sad the situation of the human beings when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remind them that they were created from alaq, from a dirty drop. And then after they look at themselves, after they are raised and they have the physical means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them, they would look into themselves and they would feel that they are independent and they do not need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wal a'yadu billah. This is the arrogance. And it's something that another act of worship that we need to witness. Everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created physically, this is ayat, this is signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that should lead the Muslim to perfect the acts of worship. One of which, none of us remember when we were born, the first instant that we came to this world. Nobody remember this. Even the most genius human being on the face of earth does not remember that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. Why the human beings do not remember the moment that they were born? Why the human beings do not remember when they were in their wombs of their mother? Why don't they remember their first days? The first thing that we remember, maybe the most that a person can remember, maybe a year and a half, 2 years, which is very rare. But usually people when they're four, sometimes they remember some things here and there when they're three. And this is from the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. For what reason? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. For people when they grow up and they have the understanding and the ability to analyze things and to look into things, to be more humble to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That they were nothing. They were helpless. They don't remember anything. That means they cannot defend themselves. They cannot protect themselves. They cannot feed themselves. And once this understanding comes into the heart of the human beings, and if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them to the truth, they would submit themselves to the creator of the heavens and the earth. The same way they were in state of submission when they were born, when they're in the womb of their mothers, and so on and so forth. So the human beings, the question is, are the human beings thinking around these lines? Most of them, they don't. Most of them are in state of arrogance, even if they're very nice and decent and everything, but they are depriving themselves from humbling themselves to the creator of the heavens and the earth alone. And the same thing with any of the creation of Allah that is mentioned in the Quran especially, that reminds the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, the provider, the sustainer, then worship Him alone, turn to Him alone, put your trust on Him alone, and this is the tawheed, this is the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has to be present in our hearts. So then, this is how the case of the human beings, and then when they hear, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided them to al-Islam, guided them to al-Iman, and then when they hear, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, they won't act accordingly, this is a shame, definitely. So over 90 verses in the Quran that starts with Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. We need to make sure that this is a job that we take, one verse after another, starting from the first one to the last one. And of course, these verses are not in the middle of nothing. It's in the middle of other verses in certain context. And one of the great knowledge or the good knowledge that a person would seek, and again, this is from the people of knowledge, is the, as the ulama, they call it, ilm al-munasabat, that you see the wisdom behind this verse in this place. Even the wisdom of the orders of the surahs that are in the Quran. There's wisdom behind it because this is the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the person will increase the knowledge that will increase the submission and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. So the verse, so that we don't take too long, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kulu min tayyibati ma razaqnakum. O you who believe, now again, once we hear this, that's it. The believers are ready. Their hearts is full of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're ready to submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kulu min tayyibati ma razaqnakum. Kulu, it's an order to eat. Eat from tayyibat. Tayyibat is the plural of tayyib. Tayyib meaning pure, meaning halal, lawful, right? Eat from what is lawful, eat from what is pure. مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ, from what we had provided for you. It is not you that is providing for yourself. It is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are just taking the means to seek the provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. So the order is to eat. So whoever deprived themselves from eating and kill themselves, this is something that is not permissible because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers to eat, but not to eat anything and everything, to eat most of the things that are clean and pure, except very few things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them impure, which is the meaning of this verse, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only ordered us to what is clean, what is pure, not according to what people might think in the streets, it's according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for us. So this is the first part of the order. This has so many rulings to it. And there are verses in the Quran, a hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So the person will take the meaning of the general meaning of this and then going into the details. What are we eating? Are we eating according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us? Or we eat whatever tastes good, whatever looks good, and then maybe we'll discuss this after we eat. This means there is the specific things that we eat, we need to make sure that it's halal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made everything permissible unless there is an evidence in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that a particular food is haram, like eating the swine or the pork or drinking wine. These types of things, which is the exception. Everything else, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it permissible, and that's why the principle in this religion, that in matters of food and drink, everything is halal, unless proven otherwise. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, for example, eat bananas, eat pineapples, eat rice, eat this, you would have endless means and endless things to eat. But the beauty of the matter is that just don't eat these certain things, which is very specific and counted things. And this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He had made matters of the religion easy for the people. But still some of the human beings, they would refuse and make it difficult on themselves when they would eat and drink what is haram, what is not permissible, what is impure. This is one part of it. The other part is to eat from what is pure, meaning seeking provisions from means of halal, so that the person, when he eats and would consume what he earned, if it's from halal and pure sources, then the provisions will be pure. Person might eat something halal, but the source of it is haram. Seeking haram money, stealing, bribery, eating usury, whatever, helping others to commit sins in his matters of work, giving someone a drink of haram or feeding someone pork, anything that would be helping people to commit sins, earning money as a result of that, is haram for the believers to do. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Help one another in matters of righteousness and taqwa, and do not help one another in matters of sins and transgression. So the means that we buy the food and consume things and wear clothing and things like that and spend on our families, it has to be from pure sources. This is an act of worship that we have to be very careful, because we will be asked in the Day of Judgment about every single penny. How did we earn it and how did we spend it, as it's mentioned in the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So this is an act of worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ بِمَا أَمَرَ بِهِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers in this verse what He had ordered the messengers to do. He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, يا أيها الرسل كلوا من الطيبات وأعملوا صالحا إني بما تعملون عليم. O messengers of Allah, this is the call for the messengers. يا أيها الرسل, O messengers, كلوا من الطيبات, eat. Again, the same word is used. كلوا, eat, من الطيبات, the same, from the pure things, from the lawful things. وأعملوا صالحا, and do righteous good deeds. إني بما تعملون عليم. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knower of what you do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ, explaining the verse that we mentioned earlier, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers what He ordered the messengers. The messengers are not in a different category that they can eat haram. No, both are ordered to do the same thing, and that is to eat what is pure. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, and He ordered the believers, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ إِيَّاهُ تَعْبُدُونَ. ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ الرَّجُلُ يُطِيلُ السَّفَرَ. Then the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the case of a man. He would travel a long distance, يُطِيلُ السَّفَرَ, and it was mentioned that it's a safar, or traveling for the sake of Allah. Safar, or traveling in matters of obedience, Hajj and so on. يُطِيلُ السَّفَرَ أَشْعَثْ أَغْبَرَ. That means he's dusty and his hair is uncombed. That means he has been traveling for so long and not taking well care of himself because of how the nature of traveling is. And all of that for the sake of Allah, not for his own pleasure. He's doing that for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means he's taken all the means for his dua to be accepted and for the good deeds to be accepted and so on. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about this man, أشعث أغبر في الصفر يمد يديه يقول يا رب يا رب. He's extending his hand and he's saying يا رب, saying يا رب يا رب. Once a person is guided and helped to make dua, this is by itself is a great bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if a person reach this level, that means he is more likely for the dua to be accepted. As Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, the meaning of which, that إِنِّي لَأَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الْإِجَابَةِ وَإِنَّمَا أَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الدُّعَاءِ. Umar radiallahu anhu said, I'm not concerned about the acceptance of the dua, I'm concerned about the dua itself. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the believers, if they make dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept their dua. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَى. That if my slaves ask you about me, I'm close to them. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ. That Allah says that I would accept and respond to their dua if they would make dua. So Umar radiallahu anhu, as the verse clearly mentions, and he understood this very clearly, that we should not be concerned about the acceptance. Just do the dua and the acceptance is with it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised. But there is a condition here that is mentioned in this hadith that would prevent the person from the acceptance of the dua, even if he took all the means for the dua to be accepted. Traveling in matters of obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has no means of luxury that would make his heart attached to it. And that's why in Hajj, when the people would be in this type of situation or state, that all the luxurious and all the materialistic things in this world that are left behind, even at the time or the day of the 10th of the Hijjah, they would even shave their head. If they look and they find themselves looking nice, even that, so that the heart is not even attached to your hair. And people look far away from being luxurious and things like that, so that the hearts will be attached only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a person having these means and raising his hand and making dua, saying, Ya Rabb, Ya Rabb, O Allah, O my Rabb, O my Rabb. But then the Prophet ﷺ said, مَطْعَمُهُ مِنْ حَرَامُ وَمَشْرَبُهُ مِنْ حَرَامُ وَمَلْبَسُهُ مِنْ حَرَامُ وَغُذِّيَ بِالْحَرَامُ فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَبُ لَهُ. That his food is from haram, his drink is from haram, his clothing is from haram, and he is nutritioned with haram. Anna is a word to be mentioned when it's something is very far away from happening. Anna yustajabula, which means far away is the acceptance of his dua. There is no way his dua will be accepted. Why? Because he is not taking the means for the dua to be accepted when he would consume and eat what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade on him. So this is such a serious hadith that shows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, and the matter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for the believers. It is for their own benefit to do what is good and to eat what is lawful and to stay away from what is evil. Evil would never bring any goodness. It's all the whispers of shaitan and the deception in the matters in this life that people live in. Also the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam showing how wealth in our life, but this hadith should be understood properly. This hadith is authentic hadith reported by Imam Ibn Majah, hadith of Abi Dharr. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-aktharuna hum al-asfaluna yawm al-qiyamah," which means al-aktharun, those who seek to accumulate so much wealth, whether from halal or haram. The goal is to have so much, and that's it. There's nothing wrong with a Muslim seeking wealth and being rich, but for what purpose? To enjoy it in this life? This is a low goal for a believer, that they seek the hereafter and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would have the same enjoyment as those who would have wealth, but their intentions and their hearts is to use this wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be grateful to Allah, as the second part of the verse says. When a person have wealth, he would be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would help the poor, he would spend the wealth in matters of obedience. At least, the least that he would do, he won't spend it in corruption. He won't spend it in haram. And this is by itself is a charity and a good deed for a Muslim to, because this wealth has to be with one or the other. And this is how people in their transaction, you are gaining something and somebody is losing that thing or exchanging it with someone else. So when you take it from someone in a lawful way, the least that a person would do, that he won't spend it in haram, in which others would spend it in haram. So when a believer, we see a believer has money, we should be happy. We should not say he's a believer or a scholar and he's rich, what's wrong with that, right? If he at least is protecting his wealth from spending it in haram, but at the same time, he is not someone that is abusing means of wealth. But the Prophet ﷺ said, the most who would have much wealth, they will be al-asfalun, meaning on the lowest level in the Day of Judgment. Illa, this is the norm. Illa, except. Illa man qala bil mali hakadha wa hakadha. Wa kasbuhu min tayyib. Prophet ﷺ said, except for those who would say with the wealth, like this and like this. Say. The Prophet ﷺ said, say. And he moved his hand, meaning actions and speech is something that is very closely related. Unless they say with their wealth, like this and like this, meaning that they give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and their kasb, their earning is from pure, from tayyib. These are the ones that even would have, if they have a lot of wealth on the face of earth, they won't be on the lowest level in the Day of Judgment. Also, the Prophet ﷺ showing the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about what is tayyib, what is pure when it comes to wealth. مَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ يَتَصَدَّقُ بِتَمْرَ. There is no one that would give sadaqah by one piece of date. That means it doesn't matter how big or small it is. مِنْ كَسْبٍ طَيِّب. This is the condition. مِنْ كَسْبٍ طَيِّب. From pure earning. This is the condition. إِلَّا أَخَذَهَا اللَّهُ بِيَمِينِ. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would take it with his right hand. فَيُرَبِّيهَا لَكُمْ كَمَّا يُرَبِّي أَحَدُكُمْ فَلُوَّهُ. And he would raise it for you, like you, one of you would raise his pony or his small horse. حَتَّى يَكُونَ مِثْلَ الْجَبَلِ أَوْ أَعْظَمْ. Till it become like the mountain or even bigger. When it started with a date and you gave it for the sake of Allah and that's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would increase it for the person. The person comes in the Day of Judgment, he found instead of one date that he gave for the sake of Allah, he found it a mountain or even a bigger. And one hasana, one good deed is better than this whole world and whatever it contains in the Day of Judgment. This is one of the ways, and this is something, if Allah give us life, we need to talk about this. How to increase our rewards. So that we don't just do anything, but to increase and to perfect our rewards. By giving just one piece of date, but with what condition? Heavy condition. من كسب طيب. From pure earning. And many verses, many ahadith in the Quran talks about this, about earning what is pure. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he was sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to order the people to eat and made halal, وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتُ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهُمُ الْخَبَائِثُ. To make halal what is tayyib, what is pure, and to make haram on them what is khabith, what is impure, what is filth. And this is what haram is. If we see this with our, not our physical eyes, but we need to see that بعين البصيرة, with our hearts, when we see sins as filth, something that is impure, something that a person, human beings, won't like to have impurities on themselves to smell bad. If sins have a smell to it, we won't be able to sit with one another. But this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we need to see how sins are like this. Riba is filth. There's no goodness in it whatsoever, even if people think otherwise. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said otherwise, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. And the same thing with all of our affairs and matters of halal and haram. Not just halal and haram, even in the doubtful matters. And that's why some of the ulama, when they defined akl al-tayyibat, to eat or to consume what is pure and clean, one of their definitions is to use what your heart is satisfied with, not what is necessarily halal. What is halal is clear. Halal bayin, haram bayin. But to eat the tayyibat is even a level that is higher than this. That's something that you might, the mufti might tell you that it's halal, but you have something in your heart with regarding to this. You're not really satisfied. Leave it for the sake of Allah. This is of course also with knowledge, because you know, you might know best and you might twist the question to make it sound like something that is easy and permissible. So even if shaitan comes and whispers to the person that if a person would do haram or eat haram or consume what is haram, this is benefiting for him. This is obvious that it's evil. But what about the things that are doubtful? Still, if you leave anything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be for sure on the clear halal and pure, this is never a loss. Because the Prophet سد الحديث إن الحلال بين والحرام بين وبينهما أمور مشتبهات لا يعلمون كثير من الناس، فمن اتقى الشبهات فقد استبرأ لدينه وعرضه. That whoever leaves the doubt for matters, he is protecting his deen and his honor and dignity. And whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would replace it by something better, definitely. And one of the originations of Islam, he said, من ترك شيئا لله لا يجد فقده. Whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, he would never miss it. If he leaves it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers to eat from what is pure, from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for them, provided for us. A person is on a mission that he would only do certain things. If he betray this amana, this trust, then he is subjected to the punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And وَشْكُرُوا لِلَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ إِيَّهُ تَعْبُدُونَ. شكروا لله, which means be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you truly worship Him. Worship is a matter of being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who provided for us? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when a person would eat or earn what is halal after doing and taking the means to eat and to use what is halal, he is grateful to Allah. He does not say, I did so much effort, I deserve such and such. No, he's apologizing that he didn't do it the right way. And he's grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he guided him to seek what is halal, that he provided for him after all, because everything is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is acts of worship that once the heart is in forgetfulness about this, life has no meanings to it. And this is the meaning of ibadah, when we humble ourselves, when we see everything is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we're taking the means, yes, but everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we would say Bismillah and say Alhamdulillah after we finish. Not just words of mouth and that we teach our children to say it and that's it. It's a lifestyle and it's a lifetime attitude that would have its effect in our ibadah, in our dhikr, in our salah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deprived the people from these provisions, who else would provide for them? No one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they need to seek provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, not from their own capabilities and strength. These are means that has to be taken, but the hearts are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. It's a very important knowledge to get to know what is halal and what is haram in matters of food and drink and wealth, right? And this is a knowledge that becomes mandatory on everyone to learn, especially at a time when people are not being focused on this, so they don't care whether they eat haram or halal. And as Imam al-Qurtubi, he talked about this fact in the tafsir of the verse of al-Riba. He said that, which is something that is well known and consensus among the ulama, he says if riba, if a person would fall into riba usury unknowingly because he doesn't know the rulings, and if this is okay, this is permissible in that case because he didn't know, riba would be only haram on the ulama only. Because most of the people, they don't understand the rulings of riba. You understand this point? He's saying that if it's okay, if it's halal, if a person doesn't know the rulings of riba, and he deals with riba not knowing, if this is permissible, if people would think that this is permissible, as we know as a general ruling, رُفِعَ الْمَوَتِ الْخَطَأُ وَالنِّسْيَانِ, if a person do something wrong, but out of ignorance, he didn't know, there is no punishment for that such a person. It's not a sin on him, because he didn't know. But he's saying, if in matters of riba, people buying and selling, or dealing with riba or whatever, and not knowing, and they would think that this is permissible since they are in state of ignorance, they do not know, then the riba will be only forbidden on the ulama only. Because riba is very difficult to understand sometimes, with the different complexities of things. So that means what? That means it's not an excuse for a person to do forms of transactions and he would fall into riba because he doesn't know that this is riba or not. He has to even seek that knowledge, or he has to ask a person of knowledge before he would do any forms of transaction. I'm not saying going to the store to buy candy. This is something that is easy and simple. We're talking about contracts, businesses, person dealing with money, with things that is very complex. We need to make sure that it's halal, that it's free from riba before we get into these types of transactions, and to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be patient with the orders of Allah. And many rulings that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the understanding and to get to learn these types of rulings. But the, if the concern is there, then we would seek the knowledge and we would learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. So this is a call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers to eat what is pure from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for them, and to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if they would truly worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لِلَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ إِيَّاهُ تَعْبُدُونَ. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.